Good evening, and welcome to this evening's meeting of the Commonwealth Club of California. I am Karen Kiefer, a member of the club's International Relations Member-Led Forum, and your chair for this evening's program. We also welcome our listeners on the radio, and we invite our audience to visit us online at www.commonwealthclub.org. And now it is my pleasure to introduce our distinguished speaker for this evening. Charles Bowden is the critically acclaimed author of many books, including national bestsellers. He's written Murder City, Down by the River, A Shadow in the City, Some of the Dead Are Still Breathing, El Sicario, the autobiography of a Mexican assassin, which was just made into a documentary, El Sicario Room 164. It won the top prize of the Lisbon Film Festival, and his book is on sale in the lobby this evening. He also wrote Murder City, Ciudad Juárez, and the Global Economy's New Killing Fields, which is for sale this evening in the lobby as well. He is a contributing editor for GQ and Mother Jones magazine, and writes for other magazines, including Harper's, New York Times Book Review, and Aperture. Chuck Bowden lives in Tucson, Arizona, and is the recipient of the Lannan Literary Award for Nonfiction and the Sidney Hillman Award. Let's welcome Mr. Bowden to the podium.
Well, hell, I guess I'm the only sanctioned noisemaker. I noticed before the program I was walking around the club that Jane Goodall had spoken here. I once had the pleasure of spending a morning with Jane Goodall, and that's the first time in my life I understood the expression state of grace. I'm afraid I'm not there yet, so I'm glad you've all had a few belts before the talk. But I want to tell you about some lies my country has told me, taught me. That's really why I came up here. Look, it's 1958, and Ramon Miguel Mike Vargas, a Mexican drug enforcement agent, tells his wife, Susie, one of the longest borders on earth is right here between your country and mine. An open border. 1,400 miles without a single machine gun in place. Yeah, I suppose that all sounds corny to you. Ramon's a fake. He's actually an actor named Charlton Heston. And Susie turns out to be Janet Lee, 2 years before she had that bad shower day in Psycho. But still, the point carries. In 1958, a B-movie out of Hollywood thought nothing of stating that the border was safe and open. Of course, Hollywood being Hollywood, it had the length of the line off by about 500 miles. Now flash forward to April of this year. This time, El Paso County Judge Veronica Escobedo is playing El Paso County Judge Veronica Escobedo. And she's testifying before the Senate Committee on Homeland Security and Government Affairs in Washington, D.C. She says, while federal law enforcement has gone on record to praise the border wall, it is to me and others an example of considerable federal dollars being spent on a rusting monument that makes my community look like a junkyard. We are indeed on the front lines, and a safe border means a safe nation, she said, but vilifying immigrants, building expensive, ugly walls, and encouraging hysteria and xenophobia only hurts our border communities, our commerce, and the economy of our nation. Senator John McCain, played as it happens by Senator John McCain, would have none of such talk. He said, I don't view ranchers who live in the southern part of my state who had repeated home invasions as xenophobic. And he said he does not believe the U.S. border is immune to being affected by Mexico's violence. There's no logic associated with that, he's noted. Well, yes, maybe there is no logic associated with that. But there's something backing up the argument that violence is not spilling north across the borders. For years, crime has been declining on this side all along the border. That's not an opinion, but something even more thrilling than logic. Damn facts. Well, look, I think we're in a sorry state at this moment in this country. We're having real problems. We seem to prefer fantasy problems. Maybe it's because of all those electronic games everybody likes to play. The current sheriff of Pinal County, Arizona, likes to talk about this border violence. Even though his county starts 60 miles and two counties north of the line, and he has said publicly that drug organizations have lookouts on 200 hills and peaks in his county. When he was asked for the locations of these lookouts by the press, he said he'd misspoken. That what he meant to say was there were 200 high points in his county that could be used as lookouts. This is the same sheriff who appeared in a political ad with Senator McCain and told him, "You get it." Well, I hope to God I don't get it, lest I wind up with a nose like Pinocchio. Look, I'll try and clear the air. I think we're being told lies. And when we argue, we use as evidence the lies we're being told. The U.S. government lies, the Mexican government lies. But you know, I give talks, and I go on radio, and pretty much every time somebody comes up after a talk, or somebody calls into the radio show, and they're always Mexican Americans, and they've always lost someone in the violence, and they're always a breath of fresh air, and they don't lie. They know that people are getting killed are pretty much like themselves. They know the people who are getting killed are poor. They know the people getting killed are not big drug folks, but mothers and fathers and brothers and sisters and aunts and uncles and cousins. They know the people getting killed are blood kin. Often the people that come up to me have tears in their eyes. I want to talk about the lies my country taught me so that we can also feel this pain and face the truth. It's last December. The first snow is falling. I'm in Santa Fe, New Mexico. This girl leans forward. She says in a quiet voice that her uncle was a sicario, a killer for a drug organization. But she says he's dead now. He committed suicide. The other people in the room fall silent. I'm in a public high school. Many of the students are here because of scholarships. All of them are here to learn the arts, dance, theater, painting, sculpture, so forth. They're the gifted ones we have, the ones we bet on and hope will bring us some truth and beauty. There are things now that cannot be said, and if said, cannot be heard. The girl who had an uncle who was a sicario, a contract killer, an uncle who finally killed himself out of despair, she can't be heard. What can be heard are shouts. And the shouts feature tiny phrases. Illegal immigration, national security, violence spilling across the border, river of iron, build a wall, war on drugs, war on terror, Minutemen, kidnappings, beheadings. You know, for a while, I got used to everybody telling lies about the border. For several years, I would visit with the Minutemen. Couldn't take a stroll without muskets, infrared, this and that, the whole basic Rambo ensemble. But I've changed. I think I'm seeing the beginning of a race war, and it's being started by my fellow citizens. I want us to take a look at some basic lies touted by U.S. politicians and believed by many, and seldom questioned by the U.S. media. Lie number one, Mexico is undergoing a cartel war. If so, it's a damn strange one, since it doesn't interfere with the delivery of drugs to the United States, and it doesn't affect the price of drugs in the United States. In the past 4 years, according to the Mexican government, about 40,000 Mexicans have been butchered. Human rights groups argue the number is well north of 40,000. Now, the Mexican government insists 90% of these newly murdered Mexicans are criminals. The Mexican government reluctantly admits it has only examined, at most, 5% of these murders. And last fall, the Mexican Senate admitted that for years, the Mexican government has been operating its own death squads. So we have dead people. And to be honest, we don't know if they were criminals or not. And we have a drug industry in Mexico that is not missing a shipment. And there's no real increase in drug prices in the U.S., the big market. Ciudad Juárez is the core of this killing. In 3 years, it has had over 8,000 people slaughtered, or maybe more. Here's a window into the unreality. Last year, the official tally of murders in Juarez was 3,100 dead. This made the city possibly the most dangerous spot on the surface of the earth. But hey, wait a minute. This spring, the Mexican government revised this number and said actually 3,900 people had been slaughtered in the city. That would give Juarez a murder rate of 300 per 100,000. New York City, our beloved Babylon, runs about 6 per 100,000. How can a tally miss 800 corpses? How can a government be trusted that can't even accurately count the dead it failed to protect? But if this is a cartel war, somebody must explain why it has no effect on the drug industry. If this is a war by the Mexican government against cartels, somebody must explain why only poor nobody seemed to die. Also, if this is a cartel war, I'd like some reporter to actually talk to some cartel people, to actually go visit these criminals. I'd like some reporter to take a break from repeating government propaganda. Yes, drug organizations fight each other. Yes, they've done this often in the past, but they never even remotely hit this level of violence. In the past 4 years, for example, the murder rate in Juarez has increased 13-fold. Lie number two, the Mexican army under Plan Merida is fighting the drug organizations. Here we enter a fantasy land that's essential for scholars and governments. It is that the drug industry in Mexico is organized with a top and a bottom. It is that by killing people at the top, we can topple the industry. I think last year, 10 or 15 bosses were killed. Some tracked to their bloody end by U.S. drones, our new favorite death toy. As I mentioned, this has had no effect on drug shipments to the United States. There is no surge in prices. There's no panic among consumers about having an adequate supply of drugs. So what's going on? Well, several things. One, Mexico is dependent on the earnings of the drug industry. U.S. outfits, like DEA, peg the hard currency earnings of the drug industry at $30 to $50 billion a year for Mexico. Now, this tops remittances from Mexicans working illegally in the U.S., tops the bucks made off tourism, and it most likely tops Mexico's number one legal source of foreign currency, oil. A nationalized industry with dying oil fields that the president of Mexico says will be exhausted in 10 years or less, and oil fields that also supply about 40% of the federal budget in Mexico. As for the Mexican army, it has had thousands of human rights violations since it joined the drug war. These violations are for little things like rape, murder, extortion, kidnapping, robbery, and, oh yeah, torture. Our U.S. State Department in a report made these charges. It has placed its people in charge of the army, in charge of various police departments around the country. It's coerced Mexican media, and it has had no influence on the delivery of drugs in the U.S. So the best way to think about the Mexican army and its 191,000 members is that it's the largest single criminal organization in the country. And beyond that, it's bulletproof. in 4.5 years of this war, with 40 or 50,000 dead Mexicans, the Army, working on the front lines, has officially lost 105 people. Good God, any decent Army loses that many a year to cirrhosis. Where the Mexican Army claims it's killed 1,566 bad guys, or about 4% of the 40,000 Mexican dead. Let's just pause here a moment. The Mexican Army fights Mexican drug organizations for almost 5 years and loses 105 soldiers, kills 1,500 out of 40,000. I'll tell you what kind of a war this is. It's a war for drugs, for the power and the money in drugs. And it's being lost by the government of Mexico because of false assumptions shared by our government. You can kill a boss, and it's got no effect on the business, except that somebody gets a new job. You can bust up drug organizations, and it really has no effect on the business, since the business operates quite well with smaller units. You can slaughter guys in the business. There's almost an endless supply of young guys eager to take up the work. I have a friend who had a young woman come to him in Juarez for counseling. She was a sicaria, a contract killer. She'd cut the heads off, I think, of, I don't know, 4 or 5 people. She needed the work. He also has women come to him for counseling, who are considering drug dealing in their neighborhoods as a more moral choice than prostitution, since they must do something to feed their families. And my friend's a minister. So you can't really wipe out the dreaded drug business for 3 simple reasons. People need the jobs, the government needs the money, and in the end, the police and soldiers all join the business. In 1 6-year period of the aughts, over 100,000 members of the Mexican Army deserted. U.S. military intelligence assumes they left the Army for the drug industry, where it pays a lot better for killing people. Ah, yeah, one more detail. Our war on drugs. After 40 years of the U.S. war on drugs, after spending $1 trillion, after creating the largest per capita prison population on Earth, drugs are more freely available than when this war began, cheaper in constant dollars, and generally of better quality. If we took these trends logically, we can see a future where the U.S. is a police state studded with prisons, where the Mexicans are all dead, and where drug prices are so low they are virtually free. How did we arrive at this lunacy? Well, by seeing others in our own image. After 9/11, the U.S. government could not imagine that such an attack could take place without a state sponsor. Turns out this hell we all witnessed that morning was accomplished by a guy living in a cave with the help of some pals. Al-Qaeda is more an idea than an organization. It can be penetrated, people in it can be killed, like Osama bin Laden, but it cannot be easily wiped out, because the notion of using terror as a political tool spreads easily. Subways in London, that train in Madrid, and so forth. I think we face the same blindness in the war on drugs. One, we're using cops to solve a public health problem. Two, we imagine drug organizations as kind of like automobile companies, where we bust the management, blow up a few factories, and we bring the devils to their knees. Well, we're wrong. There is no real center in the drug industry. Many people can produce the stuff. Many people can move the stuff. And the profit's so high that nothing stops people from leaping into the business. So here's the deal. We're 40 years into a hopeless war that creates better and cheaper drugs, kills lots of Mexicans, imprisons lots of Americans, finances lots of cops, and solves nothing, absolutely nothing. I have a friend who spent 20 years undercover as a narc. He lost partners. He killed people. He damn near went crazy with the stress. When he started working in the Dallas-Fort Worth Metroplex, heroin ran around $232,000 a kilo wholesale. When he turned in his badge a few years ago. Heroin in the Dallas-Fort Worth Metroplex ran around $72,000 a kilo wholesale. And the purity had gone up to 94%. He told me, look at these numbers. That's what I accomplished in a lifetime of work. Well, let me return to my list of lies. The wall. The wall's going to cost us $8 to $10 billion when the dust settles. And the bill will keep rising. Because the nature of walls is this. They're never really finished, but keep getting improved over time. The wall will never solve poverty. Mexicans migrate north because of poverty. The wall will never stop drugs, because drugs will come north in trucks, and the trucks will come through U.S. ports of entry, and the agents at those ports will be paid bribes. All this is already happening. But the American people love the wall because it's solid, and they can point to it and say, problem solved. And American politicians love the wall because they can point to it and say, hey, I voted for that, problem solved. At the moment, every indicator suggests the migration of the Mexican poor is stalled. But the war has little to do with it. The remedy turns out to be the collapse of the American economy. But this breather will not last. Mexico is suffering more than the U.S. in the collapse. Inevitably, wall or no wall, people are going to resume the march north. But here's the point I want to make. The wall's not about national security. The 20,000 armed agents we now have on the Mexican border are not about national security. Terrorists sensibly arrive in the U.S. at airports with nice documents. The people crossing the Rio Grande, risking their lives in the deserts of the Southwest, are not terrorists. They're poor people. The wall is part of our war on the poor. Now I come to one of my very favorite lies. I'm getting to be a gourmet on this stuff, you know. I used to be a gourmet. Violence spilling across the border. This was the favorite theme of Senator John McCain in his reelection campaign last fall, and of Senator Janet Brewer of Arizona. McCain said famously, build the dang wall. If you really care about the security of this country, get very worried when we're producing sailors that say dang. He also said violence was spilling north over the border and insisted the National Guard troops be sent to the line. Governor Brewer complained of severed heads littering the Arizona desert. Well, let's calmly review the facts. I realize fear seems to be the political drug of choice, but let's try an old-fashioned thing, facts. For the past decade, all along the Mexican border, on the U.S. side, crime has been declining year by year. El Paso, Texas, facing Juarez, had 5 murders in 2010 and was rated variously the safest city in the U.S. or the second safest. Nogales, Arizona, just had its first murder in 3 years. An ex-cop murdered his strange wife. Now, as for the severed heads, there's not been a single one found in the Arizona desert. There have been some killings. In the spring of 2010, an Arizona rancher was murdered 23 miles from the border. There have been no arrests. This was a case that inflamed Senator McCain. Here are the published facts. At 10:30 in the morning, the rancher, Robert Krentz, called in by radio from his ATV and said he was dealing with an illegal Mexican. About 6:30 that night, they found his body. His ATV was still running. He still had his gun, and his wounded dog was with him. The official explanation is that he ran into a drug scout, was killed, and this drug scout walked 23 miles back to Mexico. Okay, let's dwell on this for a moment. First, this drug scout should be pretty damned easy to find. He's apparently stone deaf. To be surprised by an ATV is like having somebody sneak up on you with a lawnmower, an electric power lawnmower. Two, this drug scout must be pretty damn dumb. Let's see, he murders a U.S. citizen, but he refrains from taking his ATV, lest he be charged with grand theft auto. Then decides, hell, the best thing is to walk 23 miles back to Mexico. Look, I don't know what happened. I know the Border Patrol found a cache of drugs on the ranch the day before the murder. I hear from people in law enforcement, no one seems to be looking for a Mexican national. My point is simple. We don't know who killed Robert Krentz or why he was killed. There is no reason for Senator McCain to demand National Guard troops on the border because of this case. But that's what he did. There is no reason for the senator and the governor to claim violence is spilling across the border, but they both did. I could be kind, I have a soft streak in me, and assume they're mentally impaired. But I think they're deliberately lying in order to get votes, and I think this kind of lying can lead to a race war. Now, I'm a little sensitive on this subject. I spent about half of each year on the Arizona border in an isolated house. It's about 20 miles to the line from the house. There's nothing between me and the line but some mountains, grassland, a few isolated ranches. I hardly lock the doors. There are times I can hear trucks of drugs moving down the dirt road in the night. Once in a while, I see guys backpacking drugs, and they're all neatly dressed in black. I don't think there's been a murder in the area in 20 years. The area has stash houses. There's been a few incidents in the past years of bird watchers feeling menaced by mountain lions, but I haven't heard the senator suggest we send in the National Guard to settle that matter. And we did have an unseemly incident of a Border Patrol agent running loads into Tucson for $500 a trip. There's also peddling maps of the ground sensors on the border. Also, about a year or so ago, they did a big drug bust in a nearby town. They nailed 20-odd people and announced they'd wiped out a major pot ring. The kingpin was driving a 1987 car. Such is the violence on this side of the border. Well, here's another one, the River of Iron. According to the press, over 90% of the guns captured by law enforcement in Mexico come from the U.S. This is always based on an alcohol, tobacco, firearm report, ATF. Well, that number isn't really in the report. What's in the report is that over 90% of the gun registration numbers that the Mexicans turned over to ATF were from the U.S. But the Mexican government, for reasons known but to God in itself, doesn't turn over a lot of the numbers. And so various examinations of the data find the guns seized from drug guys in Mexico at 12% or maybe 40%. Nobody really knows. And frankly, I don't care. Does anyone think that if U.S. shut down every gun shop in this country, the next Mexican drug organizations would be reduced to slingshots? After all, they got grenades and rocket launchers, two items you won't find in your local gun shops here. Also, there's the messy matter of the enormous desertion rate in the Mexican army. Some of the boys may take their guns with them. But what if every gun did come from the U.S.? Do you really think our right to bear arms is determined by whether a Mexican gets a gun? Look, I don't want the job of explaining this thesis to my fellow citizens. As it happens, I actually know a guy who kept 70 AK-47s in his house when he was a full-service member of the Juarez Drug Organization. 15 of them were gold-plated for the capos at fiestas. He used to party all the time with Mexican Army officers. He told me one way he and the boys imported their arms was through Mexican customs. But why this obsession with guns bought in the U.S. when there is zero evidence that most of the guns come from here? And when you have to be on drugs to imagine a business that earns $30 to $50 billion a year is going to be defenseless. I think all these lies exist for a few simple reasons. One, we all seem to like the lies because they don't cost us anything. We can be against guns. We can say drugs are bad. We can toss money to the Mexican army, finance a U.S. police state, and go on our merry way. What the hell, we can build a wall, too. We can do anything but look at the real facts on the ground. What we find is growing poverty in Mexico, growing violence, and the expansion of police and military powers, the flight of the affluent, an estimated 30,000 to 60,000 rich Mexicans across the bridge and moved from Juarez to El Paso in the last 3 years, for example. And now there are colonies of illegal refugees, people who didn't come here for economic reasons. They came here out of fear of being murdered. Since political asylum is difficult and close to impossible for Mexicans to achieve, they blend into border areas. In Las Cruces, New Mexico, for example, the local community college grew 77% in a year, and 99% of the growth was English as a second language. This is an underground community beneath the notice or compassion of the U.S. government. Meanwhile, back in Juarez, 27% of the houses have been abandoned. 40% of the retail businesses have closed. An estimated 10,000 orphans have been created. 100,000 dogs have been abandoned. And now well over 8,000 people murdered in 3 years. And we talk about violence spilling across the border. And we talk of the need for a wall. And we talk of the border as a national security issue. What we seem to skip over is that at our doorstep, the largest human rights crisis in the Western Hemisphere is happening right in front of our lion eyes. I'll make it simple. The primary force between the migration of the Mexicans north is the failure of the Mexican economy. In Juarez, for example, about half the teenage kids are neither in school nor have jobs. Every year or so, a think tank or government agency seems to spew out numbers stating Mexico is booming. You have to wonder why nobody tells the Mexican people this wonderful fact, since at least 10% of their population is now living here illegally. NAFTA, the North American Free Trade Agreement, destroyed light industry and peasant agriculture and triggered what is probably the largest human migration on Earth. Now, NAFTA was endorsed by both political parties, passed during President Clinton's first term, and it was sold as a solution to illegal Mexican migration and to Mexican poverty. It is an absolute failure. It has cost U.S. workers an estimated 200,000 to 700,000 jobs. It has created huge warrens of poverty on the border, where Mexicans work in U.S. factories for slave wages. It has, in Juarez, created a generation of children raised without parents because their mothers and fathers slave in these factories. There are now an estimated 500 to 900 street gangs in Juarez as a result. NAFTA must be renegotiated so that it neither destroys American jobs nor destroys Mexican families. It must guarantee the right of labor to organize and guarantee workplaces that are not toxic. Now, this isn't too damned hard. We managed to build factories all over this country that meet that standard. Next, stop giving money to the Mexican army. We give them about $500 million a year, so they can kill Mexicans. Stop seeing a military solution to an economic problem. Legalize drugs. The war on drugs is a failure that kills Mexicans, imprisons Americans, gives tens of billions of dollars per year to murderous scum, terrorizes drug users, and creates a police state. Albert Einstein once said that insanity meant doing the same thing over and over and expecting different results. He must have been thinking of our war on drugs. Okay, a short review. Test of 10. NAFTA's a failure. The war on drugs is a failure. The migration north of Mexicans is driven by poverty, and big walls don't answer that fact. Nobody is coming here to blow up our lives. Violence is not spilling north. The river of iron, the fact that some killers in Mexico use U.S. guns, is a sideshow, and so far has little or no factual basis. Now it's time to stop lying, because these lies kill people. Look, when I talk to that high school in Santa Fe, for kids in the arts, another thing happens. I was telling the class that they all had dreams, that they all thought about being painters or actors, or writers, or dancers, things like that. But I said, in Ciudad Juárez, you got a city full of kids their same age without dreams, kids who can't afford to go to school, kids who are in gangs, kids who are expected to be killed by the time they were 20. One girl suddenly bolted up and raced out of the room. I thought, my God, what have I done this time? Later she came back. She'd been out in the hall crying. She said she had four cousins in Chihuahua, and they all slept in one room. And when she went to visit them, they had no dreams, that their lives had pretty much ended. And then she couldn't say anything more. Well, I've outlined here our failed policies that kill people. If you want the world to get worse, if you want more death, more migration, more violence, well, continue to support these policies. Both governments will applaud you as you join their dance of death. If you say, build the wall higher, give more guns to the Mexican army, hire more police to bust drug addicts, jail Mexicans who come here to work illegally, hell, you might even get elected to Congress. You know, I was born in 1945, born into a country that had been ravaged by a Great Depression, born into a country that had paid a terrible blood price in World War II, in which 14 million of my fellow citizens had borne arms. I was born into a country that believed in the future and wasn't afraid. Now I live in a country where politicians peddle fear and even hand out free syringes so you can get the maximum dose of the damn poison. A country where my fellow citizens think poor people migrating to stay alive and feed themselves are a national security issue. Well, for me, these wars are over. These walls are a waste of my money. These border factories must no longer hold slaves. I've seen enough to know that unless there is a change in these policies, a fresh hell is coming to my town and yours. When I've raised these issues before, I've been told that my answers are simple. Well, fine, so's the Sermon on the Mount. And seeing the multitudes, he went up into a mountain. And when he was set, his disciples came unto him. And he opened his mouth and taught them, saying, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are they which do hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. Look, if you treat people like dirt, you can't complain if they get violent. We can't fix Mexico. Only Mexicans can. But we can certainly stop doing things to make it worse. We've got the largest human rights disaster in this hemisphere on our southern border. It's time to face facts or keep on lying and continuing our murderous ways and create a war against the Mexican poor coming north and create a climate of intolerance against our fellow citizens whose people came here from Mexico. We're a better people than that, all of us. Of all colors. Thank you. Okay, Bob. Are you happy to know I've been replaced?
No, you're not. Our thanks to Charles Bowden for his very informative and emotional, at least to me, presentation this evening. I'm Karen Kiefer, a member of the International Relations Member-Led Forum and your chair for this evening's program. Rather than having a mic in the aisle, John, do you mind passing around the hand mic to people because it's kind of tight in this room? So you can raise your hand if you have a question, and John will hand the mic to you. And Mr. Bowden, will you, yeah, Chuck, take over?
Thank you. What do you see as the main reason that so many Mexicans are being killed? Poor people, as you say, apparently by their own police and soldiers.
Okay. Guy, I used to teach in a university, so I like to make up answers. There are three causes. And everybody picks up a pen. I don't know the exact answer. I used to say that. You just pick a number, the causes of the Civil War, and you're suddenly heads lifted up. Look, I can't give you an exact answer. I'll give you some things that are going on. Social cleansing, the term you may have heard in other countries like Latin America. Some of the people getting killed, people in drug clinics, et cetera, are just being massacred by the government because the Mexican army thinks that Mexico would be better without them. Secondly, some of it's actual killing by drug organizations. Now, I'll give you a very quick piece of history. 2007 was the most violent year in the history of Juarez, a city of about 350 years old. 310, 320 people were killed. Suddenly, it went to 1,600 and then 2,700 and then 3,900 killings a year. That can't be explained by conflicts in the drug industry. Look at these bastards have been killing each other since the beginning of time. It's a business, not a recreation. Something else is happening. I think it's the breakdown of a society. I think after decades of mismanagement, growing poverty, et cetera, things explode. A lot of the people getting killed are failing to pay extortion. You have a tamale cart. You didn't meet your 30 bucks that week or 20, whatever, 10, whatever it is, and they kill you. And you're being killed by gangs. There's no big drug guy up saying, go hit kill that guy with a tamale cart. He didn't pay me a couple bucks this week. This is just people killing each other because there's nothing there anymore. In other words, a breakdown. But the only way you can explain each murder is to look at a murder. And here's the problem. None are investigated. There are no known facts except the corpse. Yeah, well, here.
Yes, you want
to... No, that's all right. Yeah.
How much violence on this side of the border is connected to drug cartels on that side with the distribution and gang activity?
No. Some of the violence on this side is connected to the other side, but it doesn't really happen here. For years, like in El Paso, if you fail to pay for a drug load, somebody comes to your house, puts you in a trunk, and you get a free trip to Juarez. You usually don't come back. Now, that's always gone on. It's going like Phoenix, Tucson, all these communities have home invasions. That's part of what's going on. But if that were counted, it would not significantly increase the rate of violence on this side. It is simply a misconception that violence is spilling across the border north. It is spilling south. We're giving $500 million a year to the Mexican army, for example, and they're killing people. We have a prohibition against drugs. That's killing people. I get a little tired of American politicians saying somebody in the city rolling a joint is murdering a Mexican. Frankly, they don't even know where Mexico is. You might as well say somebody having a beer in Chicago in 25 was trying to kill people. They just got out of the stockyards and wanted a beer. This is nonsense. What's killing people is this absurd prohibition on drugs. It's 40 years into the game. It's a total failure, and we ought to admit it. Look, you don't have to be in favor of drugs anymore than you have to drink Coca-Cola. This just isn't working. Yeah. Well, he's got the microphone.
I was ahead with my question then. Can you discuss the increase in violence since the militarization of the attempt to stop the drug traffic in Mexico? I mean, the advent of the Zetas and the hyper-violence that we see now?
Well,
the beheadings and whatnot. Didn't go on 10 years ago.
2 points. Wherever the army goes, more dead people show up. The Zetas originally were an anti-drug organization group created in the mid-90s, financed in part by the U.S. I have a friend, former DEA, who used to be their paymaster. But they looked at the pay scale and went south on us, and joined the Gulf cartel. They're a paramilitary group. Some of them were trained in the U.S. Think of a bunch of Rambos. And they kill people. But you don't know who they kill. What I'm saying is every time a bird falls out of the sky now, the Mexican government says it's the Zetas. It's kind of like John Dillinger in the 30s. He could rob banks the same day in seven states. But, there are lots of gangs killing people. I'm not belittling these guys. In fact, this autobiography, The Sicario, that I worked on with Molly Malloy, it's really her book. What he told us, The Sicario, is he's impressed with the Zetas. He brushed up against them, you know, in his work, murdering people. He said only a Zeta can kill a Zeta, you know. So they're good, but the violence is too widespread. I mean, a retired Mexican general floated a trial balloon a couple weeks ago in the leading magazine in Mexico and said, well, look, 40% of the country has been lost to drug organizations. The trial balloon was you have to let the army cordon off section by section, go in and cleanse it. Well, I know what that means. If you don't, I'm half German. Okay, sure.
Given the theme you set up about heading south in terms of the violence, it seems like a popular theme lately is in the media is to talk about the growing violence in Guatemala and Central America.
Oh, yeah,
so can you put that into the context of what's going on from the failed
I don't
state?
Know if I can put it into context. God, I love having a club. But is this what you people mean by empowerment? You know, you get one of these? Look, Central America is turning into a bloodbath. Grenades sell for $650 apiece in markets in Guatemala. Leftovers from our dirty little wars. They have more grenades than they know what to do with. But there's an excellent book I didn't write, naturally, called Gomorrah by Roberto Saviano. It's about Naples. And what he sees, and what I think I'm seeing, thanks in part to him, he's a kid in his late 20s. It was about the Camorra, the mafia of Naples, is you're getting an international sort of industry of crime that is the economy that has no center, that really has no capos, and then it's the economy of the future. And I really recommend the book to you. I think I'm seeing that in Mexico, Central America. I am not an expert, but it's the only way I can explain it. The myth of Mexico now, shared by both governments and a lot of the Mexican people, is two or three capos can go in a room, get sober, and stop the violence. I think we're way past that. You know, you can't put the genie back in the bottle. Well, sure.
The dialogue about legalizing drugs has been going on for quite some time, and there have been some prominent political leaders who have made noises about this and come out openly, including a former California gubernatorial candidate last year who never got out of the Republican primary, and former Secretary of State George Shultz. And I was actually here at the Commonwealth Club about 15 years ago. I heard him say that.
Yeah.
Where is that dialogue now? Is there any leader taking the helm for that?
Look, I can't tell you. I find it hard to explain how I now live in a country where people in both parties will stand up for gay marriage, and there isn't a politician in this country that'll stand up for marijuana even. That Paul Volcker said this policy is, you know, bad, you know, in this recent report. It's hardly like it's a bunch of crazy people. But I think it has to come. I mean, we can't afford this war any more than we can afford the war in Afghanistan. We are spending 30, 40 billion a year. But in the last year of the Clinton administration, we're spending about 40 billion a year on narcotics enforcement. This cannot go on. It's just like I read this morning, one of the little windows of lucidity having coffee, that we're dropping 20 billion a year in Afghanistan and Iraq on air conditioning. Jesus, I wish I took drugs, I could comprehend that. So look at it. I'm not trying to put you off. I will say this. Somebody has to stand up. They can't say decriminalize. Decriminalize is nice, but it doesn't do anything. It means you get to buy drugs, but criminals get to sell them, meaning the black market still exists. You're still giving the same amount of money to killers. And, it isn't going to work. It didn't work with prohibition. The only way you retired Al Capone was legalizing booze. Now, booze isn't good for you, although it's nice. But that was the only way out. That's why I personally don't think you can do it unless you legalize everything. We have to do what we did with alcohol. We know alcohol is destructive. We know it's violent. I used to be a crime reporter. When you look at the police blotter on Sunday morning, You're not looking at a bunch of crimes committed because the old man had a joint and beat up his wife. It's all booze, and we all know it. But we've created a system where people can get drunk, but they can't scare the horses. Increasingly, they can't drive a car. I mean, I love it. You see a bunch of alcoholics riding around the cities now on old bicycles, the new green generation. We're going to have to do the same thing with drugs because I don't see any other choice. This is, at most, a public health issue. We're the public. Cops aren't good at that. One of the reasons I'm against sending the National Guard to the border isn't that I'm against the National Guard. You know, I think every American has a right to go camping. It's that they're not trained in police work. They're trained to eliminate targets. You're sending the wrong group. Well, you're sending the wrong group to solve drug addiction by sending policemen. That's it. That's the best I can do. I know it isn't good enough, but hell, I'm only human. Okay. Well, no, it'll come.
Can you explain the ATF's Project Gunrunner and your thoughts on it?
Did I see it?
No, it's.
You mean the report? I'm sorry, I didn't understand.
Yeah, the ATF's report where they had.
Yes.
Given.
That's one of the odd things. The first, the only people that actually called them the numbers correctly. No, don't fall out of your chairs with Fox News. Of course, they had a vested interest since they think nobody's safe unless they have 7 AKs or automatic rifles in the house. But in fact, what I'm saying is it's a false issue. That I'm actually a pacifist and a coward. But if I thought closing all the gun shops in the Southwest stopped the murder of Mexicans, I'd do it tomorrow. Now, I think, are you referring to Operation Fast and Furious? Yeah, the Border Patrol agent killed December 14th in Arizona was killed with ATF guns. In other words, they'd done a sting and got stung. Same thing, there's hundreds of people killed in Mexico with guns. Our agency sold to see who bought the guns. Well, now they know. Okay, I'm sorry.
Yeah, I've had a number of relatives and friends that have told me they don't want to return to Mexico for a visit or vacation. So the tourism industry must be dramatically hurt, you know, in Mexico. And do you have a sense of how bad it's been hurt and the unemployment
that's
been
created?
Well, I
know it depends on the area. I mean, basically, people that go to destination resorts, they're bubbles anyway, like Cancun. I don't think they've been terribly hurt. Juarez is dead. Nogales is dead. Tijuana, I mean, you know, you're talking 90, 95%. The other thing that's affecting it on the border is the U.S. government. If I go to Juarez because I want to have a cold beer, I could spend 1 to 3 hours in a goddamn line getting back across the bridge. And I believe, without any question, that's deliberate. You get up there, you've been in line for hours, and there's one gate open. I mean, you know, they don't want you going. Same thing's true in Nogales, et cetera. And I know people that live on the border, or, you know, they're actually rational, even though they're my fellow citizens. And they just say, I'm not going to do that. So they stop going. This crushes border businesses in Mexico. The same thing happens on this side. Increasingly, Mexicans are reluctant to cross because the delays are so long. Well, okay. Sure.
A number of years ago, there were quite a few women that they were finding their bodies along the border. I believe it was down Juarez, and they were working. But since this drug thing, I don't read anything about it anymore, and I don't know what really ever happened.
Well, I can tell you. I can tell you what happened. I almost created that story. I'm Dr. Frankenstein. In Juarez, over the last 17 years, since 93, I think that's 17, oh God, 18. Who the hell, I don't have to count, I'm a writer. About 10% of the dead homicides have been of women. That is the same percentage as in Mexico in general. None of these cases are solved. None of the cases are solved with men either. Now, the reason you don't hear about it anymore is the death rate got so high that the focusing on women no longer seemed to explain things for a lot of people. You know, we had 3,900 people slaughtered in a city of 1 million last year, or 1,200,000. 10% were women, 90% were men. Nobody's case gets solved. That's what happened. But the issue still goes on. I mean, there are scholars who just specialize in what's called femicide, the murder of women in Juarez. The problem I have simply is it's about the same percentage of women murdered anywhere in Mexico. And in Mexico, murders get committed, but not solved. There's an excellent movie made by two Mexican citizens who got PhDs at Berkeley called Presumed Guilty. It came out about 2 years ago. It's a documentary. I cannot recommend it highly enough. You will never have another question about the Mexican justice system. You'll never use the word justice either. It's splendid. They're both attorneys, Mexican citizens. It's revelatory. PBS has shown it once. Okay, well,
okay. Oh. No, it's so funny that you just mentioned the documentary because I'm actually going to Mexico City in a couple of weeks for the Merida Initiative. And so I was curious what your opinion was of the Merida Initiative, which is basically to strengthen their justice system and to help them transition from inquisitorial to more adversarial. And so I wanted to know, was this another one of your myths? Would you like add this to the list of myths? Or do you think this could have a positive effect on Mexico?
I don't know how to answer that. Partly it's above my pay grade. Partly Mexicans have to fix Mexico. Partly this system has to be broken, I think, almost to be fixed down there. Look, I don't have a solution. The only thing I know as an American is I don't want my government making it worse. It's just like there are many Americans that used to sort of wonder why we were propping up somebody like General Franco. Well, that's the way I feel now. Our policies are hurting the Mexican people, and in the end, it hurts us. And they're not helping us. Look, it's no benefit to me or anybody in this room to have somebody working in the Electrolux factory, for example, in Juarez at a wage that's not a living wage. You know, that doesn't help us any more than it helped to move the factory there. There's an excellent book called, I think, Molly's Job by William Adler, where he tracks a job from New Jersey to the woman who gets it in Mexico. And the woman who lost it in New Jersey, whose life is destroyed, she happens to be African American. The woman in Matamoros who gets it in Mexican, her life is slavery and destroyed. That's the point I want to bring up. But these initiatives, you know, like Javier Cecilia's caravan against violence, that's for Mexicans to decide. You know, I'm a little skeptical, but I can't speak against somebody being against violence because I'm against violence. You know? But like I have friends that are Christians. I don't quite make the grade there.
Well, first I had a comment, or two comments. One, about 25 years ago, maybe it was more, working in Ciudad Juarez, I was surprised to find that all those coupons in those days that went to Pueblo, Colorado, were in fact sorted out in Ciudad Juarez. That was kind of a surprise by maquiladora women at rather low wages. Secondly, there's an amazing film, I don't know how easily available it is, about just how bad our justice system is to Mexicans. Really an indictment of the sort of racism you're talking about, Mi Vida Adentro, My Life Inside, that I can't recommend enough. And thirdly, I was wondering if you have any sort of thoughts on the increasing violence. People have asked you a bit about that within Mexico, in central Mexico, such that, I mean, I don't quite, people there are talking about it. Some say it is affecting their lives, others don't, but the state of Morelos seems to be changing, and Michoacán, within the country, according to the Mexicans, and well, I'm wondering what the drug policies have to do with that versus the economy, et cetera.
The government admits the violence is now in 17 of the 30 states. I mean, it's spreading. Juarez is no longer the center of the violence. That this is a big thing. It's like the wall is a big thing. I have a friend, Maurice Sharif, who spent 4.5 years filming the wall. Is bringing out a book this summer I wrote an introduction to. And if the wall worked, it'd be like a pressure cooker. It would build up this thing and eventually explode. But we share a 1,900-mile border. We got 110 million Mexicans south of us. And they're all going to be there in the morning, too, that you can't wall it off. This is just nonsense. But I'll tell you the truth. If I ran the world, that's next time I come here and speak, I'll be God. Look, I think this country can only sustain 100, 120 million people. I think we're overpopulated. I think we're beyond carrying capacity. I think we're destroying the earth. But I wasn't raised to take that fact and tell a Mexican man, woman, and child to go die in a ditch. That's my problem. My problem's my damn mother, you know. She taught me this stuff. Okay.
One of the things that struck me over the last...
Okay, the boss is here.
I'm sorry. This will be the last question, unfortunately. We are running out of time, but... Please go ahead.
One of the things that struck me over the last several years is how quiet the Catholic Church in Mexico has been about what's happening. Well, is that your impression, or is that just a distortion?
Yes, no. I mean, look, that's a long issue because of the historic conflict between the government and the church, and now they have a rapprochement. The Papan party that's running Mexico is muy católico. The current president, Felipe Calderón, is devoutly Catholic. And so, yes, they've been silent. In my opinion, they not completely. I mean, there have been bishops that have spoken out, but there hasn't been a slaughter like this of Mexicans since the Mexican Revolution. This is not some sideshow. Your government's trying to tell you, well, it's just drug guys killing each other. Well, I said this in some speech somewhere. I keep talking too much. I want Hillary Clinton and I want President Obama to go to the goddamn morgue and tell me which one of those corpses is a drug person. These thousands of poor people don't even have shoes. I'm a little tired of listening to that kind of crap. But then it's late in the evening. Okay, well, thank you.
We want to thank you very much for your very educational and informative program this evening. Wow. We also want to thank our audiences here as well as our radio audience. And now the meeting of the Commonwealth Club of California, where you are always in the know, is adjourned.